Yeah, thank you. Yeah, it does get brown.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Spotlight on Ferris. My name is Andrew Biggert. I'm from the law firm of Venable in Washington, D.C. ISRI has asked that I remind everyone of the antitrust laws and to point you to their antitrust law policy that should be on each of your chairs. In this regard, we've asked the presenters and we also asked the audience when it comes times for question and answers to please refrain from discussing any company-specific pricing information or from getting into any specific price forecasting. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to Greg Dixon, the moderator. Thanks.
Thank you very much. This time I'd like to ask Mike Potash to come up, and he's going to give us a brief review of Surreal Reports.
Thank you, Greg. As chairman of the task force on Syria, I'm here to delay your program with a little commercial message. When CERCLA created the Superfund program, it unfortunately involved scrap processors doing legitimate business with legitimate scrap because, in part, it didn't distinguish properly between scrap and waste. One of ISRI's greatest success stories is the passage and the signing by President Clinton of the Superfund Recycling Equity Act, better known as SERIA. ISRI members worked long and hard to achieve that success, and what SERIA does for us is offer a scrap processor protection against Superfund, federal Superfund, that is, if certain steps are taken, including but not necessarily limited to selling a valid commodity at a market price and performing due diligence to verify that the consuming facility to whom the scrap is shipped is acting in an environmentally responsible manner. Now, that last item can be kind of difficult to achieve. Not too many of us want to take a clipboard and walk into a steel mill and say, I'm here to inspect your facility. Hiring a consultant to do the investigation and prepare a report can be expensive. Well over $500 per report or per facility. Well, the good news is for ISRI members, and one of the ISRI member benefits, and this might be reason enough for any of you who are not members of ISRI to join ISRI, one of those benefits is the fact that ISRI is contracted with an independent firm to do the research and prepare reports, written reports, on consuming facilities that members order. We have a couple of different categories. We subsidize many, the board subsidizes many of the reports, the more common ones ordered by multiple members, and charge the members only $15 per report. The ones that are not subsidized are more expensive. We're charging at the rate that we are billed by the research facility, and that's $300 per report. ISRI is able to do this and keep prices down only if we get good participation in the program. Currently, we're only running 20 to 25% participation by members. We need better participation to keep these costs down and or to continue the program. Once a year, and it's been determined that annually is about the right rate to order these reports and do the due diligence, once a year from March 15th through April 30th, reports are ordered. That's called the open season for us to order reports through ISRI. It's a very simple process. You just go to ISRI.org. There's a little red guide down on the lower left part of the home screen holding a shield, and it indicates Superfund protection. Click on that, follow the directions for entering all the information about the consuming facility, and that's all it takes. That has to be done by April 30th. And before any orders are going to be processed, you will be quoted the total amount that you'll be billed, and you can choose to accept or not to accept any of the individual reports. I'm here today to encourage you to participate in that program. It's just like insurance, and it's something that we all should be participating in. I just wanted to let you know because many members have indicated they didn't know anything about it. Now you do. Please help us out and participate.
Thank you, Mike. Well, once again, let me welcome you to the Spotlight on Ferris. Appreciate you being here. We have three very good speakers for you this afternoon. Each one of them will have a short presentation, and then we'll go into a little Q&A, and hopefully at the end we can take some questions from the audience. The three gentlemen up here on stage with me today are Philip Hoffman, Sachin Shivaram, and Spencer Johnson. Mr. Hoffman will be our first speaker. Mr. Hoffman grew up in the scrap industry and has over 30 years of experience in the industry. He began working as a laborer at the Lunts, Arnn & Steel plant next to the Timken Steel plant in Canton, Ohio. He graduated from San Diego State University with a Bachelor of Science in International Trade went on to become a Ferris scrap broker for Hugo New Corporation in both New York and Los Angeles. From there, he chartered vessels at HNC and commenced that in 2008. He started Hoffman Iron and Steel Trading, containerized scrap from the U.S. West Coast to Asia, and providing consulting for scrap suppliers and major steel mills. In 2010, he was appointed by the Secretary of Commerce to serve on the U.S. District Export Council. In 2012, he was named Vice President of U.S. Ferrous Scrap Trading for MedTrade, the U.S. subsidiary of, and I'll mess this up, Kokoglu, my apologies, one of Turkey's largest steel mills. It's based in, he is based in Houston now. MedTrade directly sources scrap from small to mid-sized dealers in the Gulf Coast region to ship in bulk directly to the mill. Mr. Hoffman continues to operate Hoffman Iron and Steel from the U.S. West Coast, and we'd like to welcome him here.
All right. Thank you very much. Basically, what they asked me to do is kind of provide an overview of the steel and scrap market, and so we're going to start. And this doesn't work.
Do we have his slide presentation ready?
There we go. Okay. So global steel production reached about 1.6 billion metric tons, sort of estimated in 2012. The better estimate is on the 2000, or the better actual numbers are in 2011, but the capacity utilization was roughly 78%. So as you can see, there's a surplus of steelmaking capacity of roughly 600 million tons in the world today. Of that tonnage that's produced, roughly 442 million is produced by EAFs, and about $1.1 billion is produced by BOF furnaces. I'm sorry I don't have a pointer to point those numbers out, but you'll have to believe me on that. This shows the total utilization of scrap throughout the world. At 442 million metric tons is EAF use, and roughly 570 million tons of total, so the balance being scrap utilized in BOF furnaces. Narrowing it down a little bit, we have the international ferrous scrap trade at about 100 million tons. That's inclusive of all scrap that is traded throughout Europe across borders. And a guesstimate on the seaborne part of that would maybe be 40, 45 million tons. It's actually ocean going. This is the scrap exporting nations. Obviously, the U.S. is number one with about 21% of this of the total 100 million tons, exporting about 21 million tons. You know, it varies from year to year. The next largest is probably Japan and the U.K., a little bit out of Germany as well, out of Rotterdam. And this is an interesting chart that not too many people discuss, but of the 72 million tons that was produced in the U.S. last year, roughly 10 companies control 63%, or 10 companies control roughly 63% of the total ferrous scrap, not production. One company there is a large portion of brokerage, but for the most part, the others are all processors. This is where most of the scrap material goes. This is a five-year moving average. So if you see Turkey and China are obviously large chunks of the U.S. Export market. Last year, however, for instance, if you just took 2012 alone, it would be less tonnage than 20%. But on the five-year moving basis, that's more reflective of the actual influence it has on the U.S. Scrap export market. And this is the total China steel production. Obviously, we're all aware that China produces quite a bit of steel at 684 million tons. This year, it's probably, or in 2012, it's projected to be about 690 million because of added capacity. 75 million tons of that are EAF, and the balance being BOF furnaces. This chart shows the actual the potential for scrap utilization in China. In other words, if you take 15% of the BOF capacity and utilize scrap, as well as the 75 million tons that's EAF produced, you end up with roughly 162 million tons of scrap that can be consumed in China. And the red cylinder indicates the amount and percentage of imported scrap that China accounts for. So as you can see, it's a pretty minuscule amount that the actual international market could provide to China as a total potential of their utilization. Here you see, just to give you an idea of where China gets most of their material, obviously it's pretty evenly split between Japan and US, with other countries like Australia coming into the market. And that's a fairly consistent split, because obviously the yuan is a controlled currency versus Taiwan, which is obviously on the international trade, so there's a fluctuation in Taiwan more than there is Japanese scrap going into Taiwan versus US scrap going into Taiwan based on the currency changes. In China, that's not the case. Pretty much US and Japan split it because the yuan is centrally controlled. This gives you an idea of the amount of scrap on a year-over-year basis that's imported into China. And as you can see, when scrap prices tanked in the latter part of 2008 and 2009, rather than doing what everybody else did and to reduce the amount of scrap used and the amount of scrap imported, China came in and bought a substantial portion of the scrap that was on the international market that year. And obviously in 10 and 11, it continues. This gives you an idea of the pricing of the last chart. If you look at 09, the average East Asian price of scrap was about $305, and that's when they imported roughly 14 million tons. But actually, prices kept increasing, their tonnage actually did not, it decreased by half, but it was still pretty substantial in 10 and 11. And the reason for that is this. This chart, the red line represents the domestic Chinese price, and the black line represents the HMS price to export East Asia. So if you look closely, and I don't have a pointer to point it out, but whenever the internal price of China obviously is higher than the price of scrap on the international market, is when there's a substantial tonnage of import. And as you can see, if you look closely in 2000, obviously in 9, there was a substantial differential between the two, and then obviously in 11 and 12. So even though the price of the international scrap went up, the East Asian export price, the Chinese price went up more. So therefore, the Chinese still continued to import scrap. And this is why. If you take a look, the black line is iron ore, and it's a pretty solid leading indicator of what's coming. So if you're looking at the combination of iron ore and East Asian pricing, the iron ore has a real good indication of what the internal price of scrap is going to be. While it's not exact, because if you see in 2009, the iron ore price did drop, and the internal price of scrap didn't drop as precipitously as the iron ore. And part of the reason for that, as we all know, is that peddlers, if a price drops too dramatically, will simply go into other businesses and not produce scrap. And so therefore, the supply probably wasn't as much in China. Although iron ore, alternatively, you have the fixed infrastructure, so they have to keep producing. And that's one anomaly in this theory, but for the most part, it's a good leading indicator if you look at the other years. So the key takeaway here is that China sets a floor on global scrap pricing, and that floor is pretty much set on indications of iron ore. And then we switch over to Turkey. Obviously, we're the largest exporter, and the largest importer of scrap is Turkey at 21.5% of the total, or roughly 20 million tons of the total. And as you can see, it says 21.5 million tons was imported into Turkey from the international market. Turkey continues to build capacity despite that there being 600 million tons of overcapacity in the world. They're projected to increase it to about 55 million tons in 2014. Currently, it's roughly 50 million tons of production. And part of the reason is that the Turkish economy is growing internally, and there is various companies making investments to concur with that growth and try to do more domestic sales. This is where Turkey gets most of their scrap. Obviously, the U.S. is a fairly substantial portion of it, at 27%, and the balance of the larger countries, Romania, Russia, and the U.K. account for the balance. And as you see here, the U.S. still accounts for, irrespective of currency fluctuations, between 11 and 12, there's not much of a change. In other words, the theory that the euro is going to, you know, change the picture with respect to how much scrap Turkey imports really doesn't hold that much water. And that mainly is because the quality differential between European scrap and scrap that comes from the U.S. So our yield is higher, and therefore Turkey sort of needs to come to the U.S. To get that quality scrap, irrespective of the currencies. Obviously, if there's a huge currency situation, then it's going to change. And this gives you a real good idea of what the effect of the Turkish price is and how it correlates to the U.S. scrap market. It's fairly close in alignment. And this is a bit about our mill. We started in 1960. I'm not going to go through all the steps to save some time. But in 2010, we started our HRC production. We have our melt shop is 3 million ton capacity. We have 2.5 million tons of billet that we can roll. With 3.5 million tons, we can switch from slab, you know, from what we're going to actually melt and where it's going to go. We can also melt slab in addition to the melt shop capacity, up to 3.5 million tons. And our capability on rolling rebar is 750,000 tons. And 3.5 million tons of HRC. And we can do bloom as well, a small portion. And this is roughly the reason we're coming to the U.S. directly. As you saw in the last charts, 63% of the U.S. scrap market is controlled by 10 processors or traders. Roughly 40% of the international scrap trade is controlled by four major exporters, which creates difficulties in substantial amounts of control in the hands of a few of that material. Scrap trading companies that come into the market and buy a cargo will sit on the market, wait for the material to go up, and then resell it. So basically, we're diversifying our scrap supply chain by purchasing scrap directly and supporting U.S. small to mid-sized scrap dealers throughout the Gulf Coast region. Anyhow, that's where we're at, and that's it.
Thank you. Appreciate your presentation. Next up, we have Sachin Shivaram. He is the general manager of metallics purchasing at Servistal North America, based in Columbus, Mississippi. Prior to joining Servistal in 2012, Sachin spent 5 years at ArcelorMittal, where he most recently held the position of head of strategy and marketing at ArcelorMittal Long Carbon in Americas. During his time at ArcelorMittal, Sachin held various positions in sales, strategy, and project management in Mexico and the United States. Sachin began his career as a consultant at McKinsey & Company in Chicago, serving clients in the logistics industry. He grew up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. He earned his undergraduate degree from Harvard University. He has a master's from the University of Cambridge and a law degree from Yale University. He is also a licensed attorney here in the United States. Welcome.
Thank you, Greg. Thanks also, Joe, I don't know where he is, but for this opportunity. This is my first time at ISRI, and this is a great event. So I hope to come back in the future. And I'm actually a little embarrassed and actually honored to be talking to you guys about scrap, because I'm still very new in this industry, you know, only 4 months. So I hope you'll give me some license to say things that are maybe off the wall a bit. And I'm still learning the vocabulary of scrap. I think I see Dave DeBranis here. I think he taught me the word springboard. I've also learned that the word buy can be a noun and not just a verb. And I've also had some painful lessons on what it is to get picked off. So I'm still... Still early in this business, but I offer you my comments as kind of the perspective of, that was not Dave, but, you know, could have been, but a perspective on kind of a new buyer in the mill, but, I just wanted to offer you my comments in that regard. So, and I look forward to the Q&A when I can maybe hear what you have to say. So today I just want to say five things very quickly, and I'm not as succinct as you are, but I'm a little bit long-winded. But let me say first, I really want to thank everybody here who we do business with. You know, at Severstal, our attitude is actually we're sincerely grateful for business. You know, and I see Stan here, who's one of our mill buyers, and he can back me up on this, is that, you know, every time we do business with somebody, it's like this pleasant surprise that they were actually willing to sell us scrap. You know, we really feel that sort of gratitude, and it's not a gratitude that you can mimic, I think. I'm actually very thankful for that, and we talk about our suppliers as customers, you know, because that's really how we approach it. We're trying to sell you, you know, to sell us on scrap. So thank you again, and I appreciate this opportunity to address you. So the four things I wanted to talk about beyond that is kind of, you know, when I say the stormy market, you know, what are the few things that, what are the few learnings we've had at Severstal about this market? And I think, you know, first off, it's you know, having a good ship. I tried to work in the metaphor here of a ship in a stormy sea, you know, and so have a good ship. You know, I think we have some of the best assets in the country, and this is important for people like you, because if you're selling to the most efficient mill, then you're able to probably get a little bit more flexibility on price and what we're able to buy and things like that. So I think it's important that your customers have good assets like we do. I want to talk about that. Second, I'm saying here, like, follow your compass. You know, for us, steel prices really guide what we pay for scrap. You know, and I imagine every mill in the country before the buy is thinking about, okay, what are we selling steel for, and how much can we actually afford to buy scrap for? You know, so by definition, I think that steel prices over the long term need to be guiding where scrap is, and I'll have some data to kind of show you on that. Third, and I think this is a really key point for us, is this idea of keeping the ship steady. You know, we maybe in the past have not done this always, but something we're really trying to do now is be consistent in how we're buying scrap. And this has two facets of it. One is to buy scrap 30 days a month. We really, you know, we're trying to do this now. It's doing mid-month deals, or, you know, we just bought some scrap this week here at ISRI. That's sort of, you know, buying scrap month in, month out. There's no reason why it should be a once-a-month thing. And I think that has some perverse and not good consequences for all of us in this room when we're just doing it a couple days a month. So I want to talk about that. And the fourth is, you know, I want to say a little bit, you know, put buckets out when it rains. That idea actually came to me when I just saw the movie Life of Pi, when I don't know if you guys have seen it, but when it rains, the kid puts out the buckets. And for us, I'm using the same metaphor to talk about now this deluge of scrap substitutes that I think we're going to have in this country. You know, everybody investing in DRI and those other things, maybe there's a surplus of primes in this market. And so if and when that does happen, you know, Severstal will be putting out the buckets. So so to go on, let me, you know, if you'll humor me with a two-second commercial about Severstal, I just want to say something about our company, and because I'm proud of it, and I feel like it's a unknown in this marketplace, even though we're actually very big. You know, so you can see we're present globally. I joined Severstal here in the United States, where we're led by our CEO, Sergei Kuznetsov. And my area of responsibility is the purchasing of metallics. So you can see on the next page that these are our two North American operations. This is Severstal North America. We produce about 5.5 million tons of steel, which is melted in Dearborn, about 2.5, and in Columbus, which is 3. And to make that steel, we purchase about 3.5 million tons of metallics. So, I mean, that's a pretty big quantity, and I feel like sometimes we're the most unknown big player out there. So, you know, it's important for me that you guys see this slide. Another comment I want to make is that we have two very different assets, and it makes it personally very interesting. We have a facility in Dearborn, which is the old Rouge complex, which is probably one of the first integrated mills in the whole country. It's an integrated BOF shop, physically located within the Ford Rouge complex. So we couldn't be more kind of in the automotive market. And it's also located in Detroit, which is a scrap-rich market, which often exports scrap to other parts of the country. So, you know, that's one dynamic. And on the other hand, we have Columbus, which is a brand new mini mill that we built about 5 years ago, the newest, you know, fully integrated kind of EAF in the country. You know, just a dynamic place. It's located on the Kansas City with direct access to Mexico, which is a booming market. And, you know, on a personal note, I'm based out of Columbus, and this, when I visited this mill for the first time, is just an inspiring place to be. You know, very dynamic. We're just like a scrappy bunch of people out in Mississippi, you know, trying to make steel, trying to make money, you know, making a lot of steel. And you know, I invite all of you to just come out anytime you can, and we'd be happy to, you know, show you around the mill and talk to you about what a great job our people are doing over there. So that's our company. And one more pitch on our company is on the next slide, is that we've invested a lot of money, you know, thanks to our CEO, Mr. Mordashov, in this country, because he really believes in this country, in the fact that the steel market here is probably one of the most fundamentally attractive steel markets in the world. And, you know, we've rebuilt Dearborn, you know, pretty much from scratch. We've built Columbus really from scratch. And I hope we can harvest the fruits of this labor over the next few years. So, saying that, brings me to my kind of first of the four lessons, you know, that I've learned that I wanted to pass on and kind of discuss with you guys. The one is the steel prices guiding our decisions on scrap buying. You know, there's no question in my mind that over the long run, you know, steel is determining scrap, because the scrap has a value because some mill is going to melt it and make steel. You know, there's no intrinsic value. Well, there is, I guess, to scrap if you could use it for something else. You know, if you could use it to make concrete or something like that, if you give it some other use, maybe it'd have an intrinsic value. But really the value is, what will a steel mill pay for it? And, you know, as kind of proof of that, you can see that the margin, which is the red stuff on the bottom of this slide, you can see that it's pretty consistent. I mean, there are definitely fluctuations, and this is dependent on, you know, what steel is setting the market price. Is it Turkish rebar, you know, for instance, which is very powerful? Is it domestic hot roll? You know, is it Chinese flat roll? I don't know, but different steel products are taking the lead, but eventually it's that sets the market price for scrap, I believe. You know, and often we talk about the scrap market as if it has a life of its own, but, you know, really, and it does, in the near term, you know, scrap last month went up a lot and steel price came down. Okay, so that was clear evidence that it's not always correlated, but over the long run, you know, these two should harmonize. And so as evidence, I'm showing you what our actual margin is. So the blue line there is what Columbus actually paid for Bush, and I've, you know, taken out the prices to, you know, abide by, you know, this sort of thing. But and you can see the crew HRC on top, and then, you know, the difference there, and the average is, you know, around, you know, that unnamed level there. And I wanted to point out that, you know, if you look at January 2011, there's a sudden surge in the margin. And yes, the steelmakers made more money then. You can tell that if you go back to stock prices. You know that around that time, steelmaker stock prices were high because margins were high. But I want to talk about, you know, why did we see that surge in that moment, in that month? And my perspective is that the scrap market was not flexible enough for scrap dealers to take advantage of those higher prices and charge higher prices for scrap, because the surge, you know, I don't know, but the surge may have been January 10th to January 27th, you know? And there's a surge, steelmakers made money because they're selling steel every day, and scrap people did not make money because they missed the window in between two buys. And, you know, this brings me to my next point, which is on the next slide. And okay, so let me take a second. This looks a little complicated. It's not a design, you know, it's an actual graph, and you can read it from left to right. It's a timeline showing our actual purchases of three major grades that Columbus buys. So there's busheling, shred, and PNS. So everything that falls on a line there is what we bought in a particular buy. So you can see kind of, okay, in December we bought the three grades in a kind of a general mix of prices, and you see what happened month to month. Now, if you ignore all the little bubbles in between the lines and you just draw a connection between, and I did it just for busheling on this page, just draw a line between what the blue, the middle of the blue bubbles, you know, all the way over, that would be what some people may say is the market price, sideways, you know, from December to February, December to the beginning of February. But I would argue that, you know, and this is evidenced by the fact that, you know, in Columbus we're buying scrap out of the buy period. You know, not much. You know, the bubbles are much smaller because the bubbles here represent indicate the amount of scrap we bought. But there's a vibrant, dynamic market in scrap that's happening beyond what's going on every month. And if you're not selling scrap in the middle of the month, then you're missing out on that vibrant market. And in December to February, for instance, we talked about it sideways, but it wasn't exactly sideways. You know, there was some variation in there. And then you look at February to March, in the middle of February, you know, because in February the flows were worse, we paid more for Bush, yeah, and then we did in March, and March prices came down. And whoever sold it to us in that time made a little bit more money than he would have in March. But then somebody else sold to us in the middle of March, and he made less money than he would have made in March, but more than April. You know, so what I'm trying to convey here is that there's value in having more data points out there, more chances for us to transact, because you know there's just not enough information, there is a lot of information, but a 1 week buy period or a 2 day buy period is not enough time for people to make good decisions on what to buy or sell scrap at. And if we allowed ourselves more time, you know, a week to digest, and maybe we sell 1,000 tons and at one certain price, and then a day later at a different price, and allowed ourselves to do that, I think we'd all make better decisions and give ourselves all, you know, less risk. And you know, maybe from a personal standpoint, you don't have to schedule your vacations around scrap buy anymore. And you know, if you're sick on the scrap buy day and you miss that, like, this is a nightmare, you know? So it shouldn't be that way. It's kind of archaic that our market is that way. And in Columbus and in Dearborn, we're really trying to push the market to a 30-day cycle. And so if you're a supplier, you know, here who is interested in selling to us mid-month, we are all ears. You know, we want to talk to you here in Israel. We want to talk to you at our plant, and we want to do business with you. And I would do it more often if it weren't for the stigma of, if I come out mid-month, then it means I'm desperate for scrap. You know, I'm telling you all now that we're going to do it every month. It's not because we're desperate for scrap. And if you want to accompany us on this journey, we're very happy to talk to you. So please reach out to us. My another message is on the same theme of consistent buying. This is our actual buy in Columbus over the past few years. And some of you saw this chart. If you were in the Miami conference, my boss, Sycott, presented the same chart saying, you know, and his point was, you know, not only were we buying in a kind of a very varied manner, where you can see where we're buying a 50% deviation to the bottom from the average, up to 70% more from the average, we were buying more when the scrap was more expensive. Now, and so he's asked us, you know, me and Stan and Tim and other people on our scrap buying team, to buy consistently every month. It's easier said than done, you know, because we can't force the market to sell to us. But one of our key themes is to buy, you know, month in, month out, consistent volume. And I don't want to exclude anybody here, but I see Newell here and I see SMS here, two companies with whom we've done consistent business, and they'll back us up on this every month, whether production is up or down. You know, this month we bought the same we bought last month and the month before that, even though the steel market has been tanking, because that's part of our strategy. So again, if you value consistency, we want you to reach out to us. Now my fourth theme here is this idea of the scrap substitutes, and this has become a very hot topic in the steel industry lately. But you know, it's actually a pretty old story in the sense that, I mean, we've been talking about it for like 4 years, you know, since natural gas prices have come down, and you know, everybody's talking about iron nuggets, about DRI, about HBI, and it's because the prime availability of prime scrap in this country is just not enough to meet everybody's demand. So there's a need for something else to happen. And so the economics of DRI has suddenly become very compelling because natural gas is cheap. And you know, and I actually was on that bandwagon just a year ago. I put this chart up here. You know, I'll own up to this shame. You know, I put a chart up, you know, saying that we're gonna have a revolution in steel making, and I presented this last year, and we were gonna invest when I was at a different company in DRI making and all this kind of stuff. Now I'm singing a little bit of a different tune now that I see. Now that I'm at an EAF that we actually considered DRI making, and now we've rejected that idea. And you know, but others are still on that bandwagon. I think Merrill Lynch put out a comment the other day about, you know, admonishing steel mills that we need to neither evolve or die. And you know, I just don't think it's that stark. And I think we shouldn't get carried away with what this thing, what DRI is about. You know, I personally worked at a mill for 4 years that is 100% DRI. You know, it's difficult to handle. It's valuable for emerging market countries where the availability of scrap is not so rich as we have in the United States. But I'm still skeptical of a mill that has, you know, an availability of prime scrap using DRI to improve their costs. I'm not sure yet. You know, hopefully Nucor is successful, but personally I'm not sure. But from Severstal's point of view, we're not going to invest in that. We're saving ourselves capex, and if it does rain prime, you know, substitutes down on this country, I think that'll be a great opportunity for us to buy more primes, and that's our perspective. So those are my four messages. You know, I just wanted to recap and say thank you to everybody for listening and humoring me on these comments, and I hope to answer some of your questions in a little bit.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Spencer Johnson. He's been with INTL FC Stone as a part of the metals risk management team and has been the primary broker for ferrous metals at the firm since December of 2009, during which time he has worked to develop a commercial risk management platform for various ferrous businesses from scrap and raw metals to distributors and OEMs. He also publishes a widely read commentary on ferrous future markets, the FC Stone Steelwire.
Thanks very much, Greg. Appreciate it. It's good to be back here again. Thanks again to Isri and to Joe Pickard for having me back. I'm glad I didn't offend anyone too much last year in Vegas. They're nice enough to ask me to return. I'm going to be covering some of the same topics that I covered last year, but things have changed quite a bit as far as ferrous scrap risk management just in the last 12 months. One of the reasons why that's the case has been the introduction of some new contracts. But before I talk about those new contracts, I have to throw my disclaimer up here. Not selling anybody futures or options just yet. We're just talking educational material. We want to talk a little bit about, you know, what these contracts are, how are these contracts created in consultation with who, and how can they be utilized by the industry. I titled my presentation Evolution in Scrap Risk Management for a reason. I think it's because the sophistication level necessary to be successful as a ferrous scrap broker, as a seller to the mills, becomes increasingly important as volatility in ferrous markets increases. The unpredictability of export markets, the unpredictability of demand for finished steel products, the rise of both the Turkish and East Asian demand on U.S. scrap that Phil's presentation spoke to. I think those, and accordance with what we see as less reliable seasonal trends in ferrous, I think a lot of people saw that particularly this last winter, that those things have made it more difficult to manage inventories of ferrous scrap, and that's why the CME and some of the LCH, other exchanges around the world have been looking to list new contracts for ferrous products to give the market some way to sort of manage that volatility and protect the margins in a world of volatile both finished steel and scrap prices. The last point on the intro here is that, you know, because risk management has become such a day-to-day part of doing business in non-ferrous scrap metals, we think that particularly those yards who already have the infrastructure to be hedging their non-ferrous scrap now have the instruments to implement some of the same types of ideas on the ferrous side of their businesses. And I think that that spells success in the future for busheling futures in particular. Here's a little bit of information about the CME's busheling contract that was just listed. The contract launched last fall, so it's still sort of in its infancy. But some important highlights about the contract. It's a 20 gross ton contract. That should make sense for those shipping scrap to the mills. I made a bullet point at the top about the correlation, and I'll talk a little bit about correlations of scrap prices in the U.S. across region, across grade, and also in the international markets versus the U.S. markets. But one thing I wanted to note is that there's a above 99% correlation of Pittsburgh busheling prices to Chicago prices, and that's based off of the AMM indexes. And that should present limited basis risks for those who are looking to hedge with a U.S. Midwest index, regardless of where you're located regionally. So as long as you're not in a market that sort of doesn't follow what's being said in Detroit and Chicago and some of the other Midwest markets, then we think that you could reliably, based on the historical correlation, hedge your purchases and sales of ferrous scrap against a busheling index like the AMM's Midwest number one busheling futures index. The only other things that here is that, you know, the listed contracts is noted that it trades out 24 months. Right now, on last check, there's no open interest for the contracts beyond December of this year. But that is encouraging that a contract that's basically been around for less than half a year already has open interest in some of the contract months out as far as December of 13. Here's a little illustration of that correlation of Pittsburgh to Chicago prices that sort of suggests our point. But another point that I think is useful in this chart and one that we always is sort of a driver for hedge demand anyway, is volatility in prices. And one of a sort of quick and dirty way of thinking about volatility in our mind is to look at the standard deviation as a percentage of the mean price in a given year. Obviously, you know, going back to 2008 when we had a huge plummet in prices, that standard deviation as a percentage of the mean price is inflated there at 34%. But even when you drop that outlier, what you see is that volatility in scrap prices is still fairly elevated, and that a one standard deviation move in the price is enough to eliminate almost the margin of almost any particular seller, recycler, regardless of where you're at in the industry. And so that's one way of thinking about whether or not you need to hedge, in our opinion, is you know, where is your margin relative to the month-to-month change in the price, so that if you're sitting on inventory, how exposed are you to an adverse price movement? That's sort of the foundational decision that we think you need to make when you decide whether or not your business should be hedging ferrous scrap or not, is what does your margin look like, what is the cost of protecting that margin, and what do you expect the volatility to be like over the course of your inventory cycle? Here's the forward curve that we see now in busheling. You'll see that it's, in futures markets, we call this backwardation between now and about September and October, meaning that the market currently expects that prices will be lower almost throughout the remainder of the year. That's mostly an opinion on fundamentals right now. Obviously, there's not a lot of excitement about steel demand in 2013. And because there's not a lot of excitement about steel demand and generally, you know, macroeconomic factors, global growth, et cetera, you would expect that the forward curve would be in backwardation. In other words, tomorrow's price is less than today's price. That's also mimics the iron ore forward curve, which is in massive backwardation right now, where you go out a year on the iron ore forward curve and you're talking about probably at least a $20 discount to spot, which just goes to show you what the, you know, outlook is, I guess, for some of these ferrous products, and perhaps that suggests that the need to protect margins may be higher than it has in past times. I also make that note about liquidity beyond December 13 at the bottom of this contract. So I think that forward curve is a good indication up to about December, and the expectation, as you see in this chart, is that Q4 should expect a little bit of a pickup from Q3. There's another contract, though, that we want to talk about for those who are looking at busheling and sort of U.S. scrap prices. We think AMM is going to make the most sense for you from a correlation perspective. But for export markets, for buyers who are, you know, on the international market, this is sort of ultimately substantially backed up by what Phil was talking about the substantial demand that Turkey has for U.S. scrap, which explains the high correlation between a CFR Turkey price and a FOB East Coast price, for example. And to take advantage of that, a couple of the exchanges have listed a CFR Turkish HMS contract, and that those contracts clear at least on the LCH, and there's a version of this contract that clears on a Platts index on the CME as well. These are 20 metric ton contracts, cash settled against the steel index, price average, that's a daily index, which I think is reflective of the fact that, you know, there are purchases and sales going on throughout the month in the export markets, and that average is what's used to settle against a purchase or buy of the futures contract. You'll notice this chart is very similar to the chart that Phil showed you, but a little shorter time frame. This is only going back to January of 2011. And instead of comparing Chicago prices to Turkish prices, we're comparing HMS East Coast to Turkish East Coast. And the correlation, as you can see there, is incredibly high. It's above 98%, regardless of whether or not you're looking at it on a 2012 basis or on a since 2011 basis. If you go back a few more years, the correlation continues to hold up at least above 95%. I would encourage, the TSI guys are great. They give out a lot of good information about both the way that the contract is handled and the way that the prices are arrived upon for the index. And we have a confidence in the way that index reflects the physical market based on the historical prices that we've seen from them. That's always important when you're talking about hedge effectiveness, because basis risk is always one of the most important things. And I'll talk a little bit about what that means here in a few minutes. This is the forward curve for Turkish. The main difference between this sort of anticipation of prices in the market for Turkish scrap versus U.S. scrap is that, again, you're seeing some backwardation between now and about Q4, but things are expected to pick up more in the Turkish market beginning in 2014, and we think that's probably a reasonable expectation. Again, there's almost no better way to determine what the market thinks about a forward price other than what people are willing to actually bid or offer in the forward markets. So this is not my opinion of what prices are going forward. This is people's actual bids and offers and trades that are in the market for the forward months for HMS CFR Turkish ports. So this is another slide that I like to show that is particularly interesting for the recycling business, because there's an understanding that we're dealing with different products, and that when you're dealing with these different products, that ultimately you would expect that there'd be divergence in prices. But particularly since the beginning of 2012, you see a pretty high correlation there between the obsolete and the prime grades. That correlation falls if I was to take this study back to say 2008. But just in the past year and a half or so, that correlation has been pretty tight, which to us suggests that now you have limited basis risk, at least using historical data for the last year and a half or so, about hedging obsolete grades basis a prime grade contract, which hopefully will make the contract more attractive to those who aren't handling prime grades, maybe only handling obsolete grades, for example. The ultimate goal, in my opinion, for futures contracts for ferrous scrap is to achieve something like what LME aluminum futures have achieved. The contract specifications are up here, and those of you who deal in substantial volumes of aluminum scrap are probably already familiar with those contract specs, because for the larger players in particular, hedging their aluminum exposure for scrap inventories, scrap purchases, and scrap sales have sort of become a normal part of doing business, the same way that it has been in copper for years. And I think that there's no real reason why that this process couldn't be adopted on the ferrous side of things, where volatility is just as pronounced. In fact, one of the things that I always hear when I'm talking about futures with people is, well, but don't futures introduce speculation and volatility? And the ultimate answer of that, and there are numerous economists who have done historical studies on this issue, is that a futures market actually tends to smooth out volatility in the long run in commodities. And we've kind of entered a period of lower volatility in aluminum prices recently, in terms of our crude metric of standard deviations as a percentage of the mean. So this is a chart of both 3-month and cash aluminum prices, and I think that the liquidity situation in aluminum is the end point and sort of the end goal of where we'd like to see ferrous scrap contracts arrive someday. But in the meantime, there are both advantages and disadvantages of sort of the contract being in its nascency. But want to talk quickly about what we think you can use this contract for if you're a scrap recycler, particularly one who sells decent volumes to U.S. mills. We think that the ideal scenario is for those recyclers to hedge their forward sales. Sachin will be able to speak to this to probably a greater extent than I can, but I think that one of the biggest problems for steel mills is anticipating what your input costs are going to be in order to determine what you can offer for prices for finished steel. What you can do as a recycler and a seller to the mills is to offer a fixed forward price without worrying about the risks that the market will move against you between now and where you've set the price for your buyer. The way you do that is by hedging using the futures market. The chart below here is a pretty simple kind of explanation of how you would do this. You're inevitably going to be short physical scrap. You're selling it to the mill. You have a fixed price to the mill. Why? Because usually the mill might pay you a small premium if they knew what they were going to pay scrap for you to purchase scrap from you for in, say, October of this year or September of this year. Previously, the recycler and the seller of the mill really had no way to offer a fixed price for that long dated of a contract without exposing themselves to a massive amount of risk. Obviously, we know from the charts before that there's a considerable amount of volatility in the market. Previously, the seller wouldn't know if they'd fixed a price for October whether or not that price would be above or below the market price when the time came. Ultimately, that doesn't matter if you're hedged, because you can sell forward to the mill at your price, negotiated between you and the mill has nothing to do with the future side of things. And then you can sell, or excuse me, buy, if you're selling to the mill, then you buy futures contracts equivalent to the volumes that you've sold to the mill. That way, if October comes around and you've fixed a price to sell bushling to the mill at $400 and the price is $450, now you're kicking yourself in a world where you haven't hedged because you could have gotten $50 more a ton in the spot market then than you would have been able to achieve had you fixed the price ahead of time. But if you'd been long futures, you would have profited on that increase in the price to the same extent, meaning that the risk that you had that you sold below the eventual market price is offset because you've taken the equal and opposite position in the futures market. And ultimately, that's the end game of hedging, and it's what really is the most simple part of it. A lot of people talk about the complexities of hedging, and I don't know if maybe it's too sophisticated for my business, and so forth. Really, really simple. If you have the opposite position in the futures market that you have in the physical market, then your risk is limited to whatever the basis differential is between the futures contract price and your physical price. And that basis risk is ultimately can be alleviated if you've fixed the price against the mill with the same index that you've sold or bought futures against. So there are ways to manage that basis risk. There's also ways to make that basis risk work in your favor. And that is my next slide here. There are sort of two really important issues to keep in mind when utilizing scrap futures as they're still sort of in their nascency or relatively illiquid phase. Because there's liquidity issues, it means whether or not there are more buyers or sellers in the market, you want to be on the side where there are fewer, obviously. And in order to do that, you know, it depends on where you're at in the market, but it does mean that you can achieve better or worse prices crossing the bid-ask spread in an illiquid market. But basis risk is the main focus here. Much like liquidity issues, it creates both opportunities and risks. So the basis risk would be that the futures price comes out of line with the index price. So you want to make sure that you have confidence in the index, whether or not it's the TSI's index price or the AMM's index price, before you want to utilize one of those contracts. But keep in mind that your regional differentiation, the price that you pay in your local market for physical scrap and sell physical scrap at, if that basis differential is in your favor, then that's something that can actually work for you as opposed to working against you. If you're selling futures at a premium or buying physical material at a premium, you can make that work for you, basically. I want to talk a little bit about sort of some of the success stories in Ferrous, and one of the reasons why I'm encouraged that I think that scrap futures have a good chance of succeeding. And one of those is iron ore. Obviously, this is, you know, the primary raw material for steel producers that are BOF and that aren't, you know, if you're not using scrap, then, you know, there are scrap substitutes, but most mills are using iron ore. And the success of futures here and the ability to hedge input costs for steel producers has been, you know, wildly successful. If you look at this chart below, you see, you know, monthly volumes on the SGX, which is where most of the volume is, the Singapore Exchange, have exceeded, you know, 18 million tons and now make up a pretty significant percentage of the actual annual seaborne trade in iron ore. And I think that that's an encouraging statistic going forward in terms of the ferrous market's maturity and sophistication and its willingness to embrace some of these risk management practices. There is another success story, and that is CME HRC futures. Obviously, these are on the finished side, and I think that there's lots of opportunities to use multiple contracts to do your hedging. For example, the differential that Sachin spoke about between HRC and scrap prices. Now you have the ability to trade that differential because you have ultimately what the CME is calling a virtual steel mill, right? You have scrap futures, iron ore futures, and finished steel products. HRC is the most liquid, but there are also Chinese rebar futures, and the exchanges are constantly listing new products as demand grows for them. But HRC in particular has been encouraging, especially since we've had record volume months both in March and in February. Our customer base is particularly interested in HRC because it's more liquid than some of the other alternatives. And I think that it's encouraging that steel service centers, physical traders, manufacturing companies, all of these have used HRC futures to their success, which is why you see, you know, substantial growth in volume since the inception of these. Keep in mind, these are, the HRC futures are also relatively recent, and ferrous contracts in general are fairly recent. We've only had a futures market in iron ore and in finished steel for less than 5 years in most in instances of most contracts, and they've been liquid for even less time than that. So these are still markets that I think have opportunity to get involved in it in their early stages. And I'll wrap this up by saying that I think that, you know, what some of the charts and historical data have suggested is that we think that scrap prices will continue to trend together to some extent, but that when they don't, that those divergences create trade opportunities and basis trading, or what we call arbitrage opportunities, for recyclers and for sellers. We also think that volatility, you know, shows signs of increasing in ferrous markets. No one knows where the price is going, but that in and of itself is a reason to embrace risk management, we think. Even though market liquidity is in its emerging phases, as we've noted before, we think that you should keep an eye on volume growth. The first 6 months of the AMM busheling contract have been pretty good in terms of customer interest that we see, as well as trade interest, compared to the first 6 months of most futures contract launches. Futures inevitably is a sort of a chicken and egg issue, where a lot of players say, okay, I see this, I see the value in it for my company, but I want to see somebody else doing it first and utilizing it first. And I think that's why HRC and iron ore have been so successful, is that you've seen companies come out, particularly some of the steel service centers, and say, look, we're using these contracts and it's really working to help alleviate risk for us. We see that there are similar opportunities in scrap. We also think that there are arbitrage and basis play opportunities between steel and scrap futures, as well as between scrap and iron ore futures, in terms of trying to arbitrage the differential and the input costs for the mill. Last thing, I get my own 30-second commercial here. INTLFC Stone has done a lot of work to, particularly with mid-sized entities in the scrap market, to try to create a risk management process that works for you specifically. We do a lot of consulting work in that sense, and I think that growing volatility and the importance of risk management in ferrous, because they're growing, I think this is a market that's somewhat underserved in terms of having somebody come in and really get into the details of your business and what you're doing, and whether or not it makes sense to utilize futures and options for your business. Thank you.
Thank you, Spencer. Now we're going to proceed into the segment where we do a little Q&A here, and we'll talk a little bit about the international markets, and then we'll have some questions also in regards to the domestic markets. Generally, what are your all's expectations for demand in key overseas markets like China and Turkey for the balance of the year?
On our side, you know, the Turkish market is always a bit volatile, and the quite honestly, the Middle East is not buying as much finished product. As a result of all the circumstances that are happening politically. However, the Turkish economy is the fastest growing economy in the world, or not the world, sorry, in the European Union, at about 2.2% right now. The government is investing quite a bit of subsidies, et cetera, to build infrastructure. I was just with the Minister of Economics last week, and so there's gonna be good demand inside Turkey. There's also obviously more capacity being built in Turkey, as I pointed out in the slides. So therefore, it's going to be kind of a balance. Right now, it's not the best circumstance, and you know, the prices are being pushed down because finished product levels are not able to be sold longer term, sold at reasonable numbers based on the conversion factor of scrap into finished product. But longer term, I think it's going to be reasonably good. Because of the internal investments that are going on for the growth of Turkey. China, you know, it's always a wild card. It really has to do with depending on the price of iron ore versus the price of scrap. And so the Chinese were for a while dumping finished product into the market, which was having an effect. Now it seems like their economy is retracting some of those cheap exports. So it looks like their demand is going to be continued, but not necessarily a huge increase.
Sachin, any thoughts?
She don't have really comments on Turkey or China.
I think that you know, it's obviously highly unpredictable, but I do think that there are certain concerns, particularly from us for East Asia and China, is a concern. I think the unsustainability of overproduction there has me worried about what the future of the industry there is and what it means for their scrap demand going forward. I think that there's more question marks there than there's been in a long time.
Well, and that leads us into the next question, which was kind of referring back to China, is that do you see a period in the near future that they'll become self-sufficient when it comes to internal ferrous scrap?
Again, on the charts, there's so much capacity there that could be used or not based on what the iron ore price does. So everybody talks about this, well, they're going to be self-sufficient by 2015 or 2020. It's kind of like, well, not really, because it all has to do with if the price of iron ore is such that it permits them to continue to use, the BOFs to continue to use, 95% iron ore instead of, 15% scrap and 85%, then, that's going to have an effect. So it's really a question as to how that's going to actually flush out.
Sure. Anybody else?
Yeah, I mean, just looking at their production figures, I mean, obviously, if they're pumping 600 million tons of steel into their economy every year, and maybe it's not going to be ready to come out in the next 10 years, because a lot of that's construction related, so maybe it takes 20, 25 years to come out. And also their 600 million production rate is recent, relatively. It's been a lot less before. So I think it'll take longer than maybe 10, 15 years for this scrap to start coming out. And whether they're self-sufficient or not, I don't know, but it'll come out eventually.
Yeah, I would say it's hard to say. I mean, obviously there's a growing automotive market there that eventually will be useful, but I do think I agree strongly with Phil that the price of iron ore is a massive factor there. And I think that one of the things that I'm, that provokes in me is the idea that there's massive mine expansion going on this year, especially in the second half of the year in Australia. And I read a figure, I can't remember where it was, that Rio Tinto, the equivalent of what Rio Tinto produced in iron ore in 2012 is being added in new capacity between the major three Australian iron ore miners, Rio Tinto, BHP Billiton, and Fortescue, among the three that I think were mentioned in that particular piece. So if that significant amount of iron ore comes to the market in a world where maybe finished steel demand is depressed and the Chinese aren't willing to pay as much for iron ore in the second half of the year, coupled with a lot more supply, I think that low iron ore prices might be more of a factor in terms of their direction and scrap demand.
And let's not forget about the European economy not doing so well. I mean, it's...
That was my next question. I like that. Speaking of Europe, obviously, their economy has been down. And with the turmoil that's been happening in the Middle East, if some of this starts to either the economic conditions improve or some of the issues going on in the Middle East start to settle down, what impact do you think that'll have then towards scrap prices in the future?
Well, from our perspective, obviously, we're selling those are two main markets. It's going to be the Middle East, North Africa, and Europe for export of our products. So if there's improvement in those situations, both economically in Europe and politically in the Middle East, then obviously that'll mean we'll be able to continue to sell finished product into those markets and restart and be competitive. Right now, though, Europe is just seemingly taking forever to try to get it together, and who knows how long that will last. So obviously it'll be good, but when it'll happen, anybody's guess.
Gotcha.
I guess my very small window into what's going on in Europe would be what we see in terms of prime scrap exports from Europe, and we've been seeing some very competitive offers of prime scrap export over the last, I'd say, 8 to 10 months. And if the economy there picks up, then you wouldn't see those offers into the United States, which I think would have a pretty significant impact on prime pricing in the United States, because those imports do, satisfy a key kind of marginal portion of the market, which U.S. mills would have to reach further away or into scrap substitutes to meet that demand. So I think it could, a slight uptick in Europe could have an impact on prime pricing in the United States, but so far it's having the opposite and kind of depressing prices, I think.
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, I think that I would agree with that. And I also think that the currency issue, as Phil mentioned, a substantial move in the euro does have has an effect. Even though there's, minor fluctuations that are overwhelmed by the grade differential issue, if you do see a substantial improvement in European economic outlook and that has an effect on euros, the euro price, then I think that that's probably something that's worth considering in terms of the outlook for demand. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I thought this was an interesting question. I'll be interested to hear your opinion. Do we have an overcapacity of scrap processing here in the United States? I know we have overcapacity on the steel making side. What do you think about your opinion on the processing side?
Well, my perspective is that recently I saw some statistics that there's something like 351 shredders, and it's continued. The trend has increased over time for the number of shredders in the United States, as well as number of scrap yards that that continue to open up. The barriers to entry on this are fairly low, depending on what type of scrapyard you want to open. So there is, to me, if I look at the trend of the amount of scrap that's actually been produced over the last 5 years, it's remained actually on an increasing amount. The year before last, it was 75 million. In 12, it was 72 million. Before that, it was probably 65, something like that. So it continues to increase. So there is more scrap yards fighting for the same amount of scrap, more shredders fighting for the same amount of scrap, therefore squeezing margins of each of those. And we can see that in the results of some of the larger consolidators that haven't been able to make margins.
Sure. I think we're in the midst of an audience that probably feels that there is a significant overcapacity in processing. And if I say no, there isn't, I think we're going to get a lot of groans. But let me just say that I guess a couple complicated related points. One would be, I think shredders have gotten better. In terms of the capacity you can buy per dollar is probably a lot better today than it was 20 years ago. And I see eight people here who can answer that question better than I can. But so if we're measuring overcapacity just by the fact that somebody can process 20,000 tons of shred a month, but he's only doing 10, and that to you means overcapacity, then okay, yes, there's overcapacity. But I would measure overcapacity a slightly different way, which is I think it's right to put in scrap processing capability to optimize freight. Like if we have shred feed that is moving too far and and the industry is losing money to the freight industry on moving that shred feed too far, then we need to put a shredder in the middle of Mississippi, to optimize the freight because it shouldn't have to go all the way to wherever, to be processed. And as long as there isn't kind of craziness going on in the freight where people are paying, ridiculous prices to keep their shredders operating, and that is increasing our total freight cost as an industry, then I'd say there's no overcapacity. But if we see that that sort of stuff is going on, then I would say, yes, there's overcapacity, and people are just trying to keep their assets running, which, my sense is we're kind of on the verge of that. And so it feels like it's getting a little saturated to me.
Yeah, I hear the same sort of anecdotal stories that probably generated that question about scrap, shredders that have no real connection to any nearby, buyers and things like that, but I wouldn't have much else to add beyond the sort of anecdotal stories I've heard about shredders in the middle of nowhere.
I mean, I do want to make an additional comment on that. Interestingly, the potential for the old type of shredder spoke and hub, where you have a large shredder that has to gather material in to run so many tons through in order to justify its existence, may be giving way to the portables and the smaller shredders. So the fact that there's more shredders on the market or out there, it kind of depends on exactly how you define a shredder. And if you have shredders that are portable, which would be smart, which goes to your point with respect to freight, if you have a small scrapyard that does 3,000-4,000 tons a month, and doing a portable shredder may make a lot of sense because they don't have to transport it to these larger shredders that then have to feed 20,000, 30,000 tons into the shredder just to make a profit. So I think that there might be a trend, depending on the capacity and the quality of the portable shredder, to have smaller yards put in their own. Therefore, they have the ability to market shred and, of course, get the non-ferrous.
Good point. Backward integration in regards to the steel mills getting into the scrap industry. You know, do you think that that has been a successful trend? Will we see more of it? And what impact do you think that's going to have in the coming years?
I think every steel mill thinks it's a good idea, you know, us included, to secure everything upstream and downstream. I'd love to make cars, you know, and I'd love to like be able to process all the shred and do the whole thing. But everything has a price, and I feel like the prices the industry paid in the 2006 to 2008 time period were too expensive, and everyone was kind of burned by that. And now we're all kind of once burned, twice shy, and not going after that thing. But if things come at the right price, I'm sure everybody in the industry would love to be integrated.
From our mill's perspective, we really are focused on supporting the people. We don't really necessarily want to be in the scrap business. We want to support the dealers, the small and mid-sized guys that already are in the business, because that's what they do. And as a large corporation, as a steel mill, there's a hierarchy. And the difficulty is when you're trying to compete with, you know, smaller businesses, the scrap companies, they're entrepreneurial. You know, they're going to, the family structure in that in this type of industry is really, I think, the best structure. And so we're interested in supporting those companies to be our suppliers rather than, you know, being some of these consolidators that open up next door to some of these suppliers. Yeah. And that's an important point.
Last question. I apologize. We're going to run out of time before we get to take many questions or any questions from the audience. But what do you see happening the balance of the year in the steel industry? And what I mean by that question is, what's going to be the trigger that pulls the economy forward a little faster? Is it political? Is it more construction? Is it building cars, you know, and things like that continuing to go at a high rate? What factors do you see hopefully pushing the economy forward for the rest of the year that would obviously help both the steel and the scrap industry?
You want to take it first?
I guess I'd again answer it with based on the limited vision we have from our steel mill is, you know, we're in Dearborn and we're in Columbus, and so we operate across a wide range of economic sectors, and there's real lopsidedness. I mean, automotive has been very strong. You know, and Dearborn is full and it's great, and because that's an automotive focused mill. But in Columbus, we are not so tied to automotive. It's everything else. It's construction, it's road building, it's, you know, appliances and all the other things that make up the economy. And I think right now the economy is kind of, you know, in our sector of the industry, it's focused very much on auto. That's very strong. And maybe in the broader economy, government spending is very strong, but there's all sorts of pockets in the economy that are not doing well. So I think what would, you know, help push us towards this uptick would be kind of these other lagging sectors in the industry, construction or whatever, services or whatever it needs to be, everything recovering and not just a few kind of, you know, very notable parts of our economy like automotive or government spending.
I think it's a lot of it, at least in my sector in Texas, is the energy. I mean, you know, if we become, and we are becoming much more interested in natural gas and the shale oil and all that, the pipe mills, pipe is actually doing very well. That sector of the economy in our particular area is good. Also, government spending on the highway infrastructure, et cetera, is going to do it. The Keystone Pipeline, you know, obviously should be something that's enacted. But you know, it's difficult out there because the Fed keeps pumping money in, and who knows how long that's going to continue to be sustainable. So there's a lot of dangers out there, I think. But for the most part, there's some sectors, like you said, that are doing well, and hopefully will continue to go forward.
Spencer,
I think we need some help from outside the United States in terms of U.S. export markets. I mean, if you look at sort of the health of the U.S. economy, obviously there are a lot of things to point to and be disappointed about. But at the same time, seem to be doing quite a lot better than some of our you know, key competitors. And I think that one of the things that would really help is if you saw a stronger global growth trend in our key export markets. Demand for U.S. manufactured goods, I think manufacturing will be an important part of the recovery. And I think that, but what that needs to be successful is a better growth trend in places like Europe and some of the other places in the world that we're dependent upon for our export market. Mm-hmm.
Well, gentlemen, thank you for your comments today. I hope you guys found it informative, and we'll see you again soon. Thank you.